The International Labour Organization, an agency of the United Nations, earlier this week released a report looking at the global impact of the coronavirus pandemic on the global workforce. The organization notes that workers and businesses are facing catastrophe in both developed and developing economies and says nations have to move fast, decisively, and together. Right, joining me now to look at this is the Vice President, Industrial Global Union, Issa Aremo. Good morning, Mr. Aremo. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much, Timothy. Let me say good Friday to you and also our Muslim colleagues, Timo Mubarak.
All right. Are you worried by this report by the ILO about the looming job losses globally due to the COVID-19 pandemic? 195 million jobs could be lost globally.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's quite a big shock to the international market. If you can recollect, last year marked the 100 years of the International Labour Organization. I was privileged to be in Geneva in June last year. And with all the scenarios, I mean, we are talking of future of work. The idea is that more jobs will be created with Internet of Things, with the movement to the fourth industrial revolution. But all of a sudden, nobody thought of COVID-19 and the impact of jobs. I think the ILO has released the report, as you said. The lower case scenario is about 5 million jobs that will be lost immediately with the impact of the lockdown. But the worst case scenario is up to about 25 million. Of course, that's the global picture. But when you also compare it to what happens in specific countries, don't forget that before the coronavirus, Nigeria is talking of open unemployment of close to 40%. And that means that with the closure of factories now, workplaces, there will be more serious way of unemployment, not just direct job losses, but even gross underemployment. I mean, even those who are doing working, you know, you know that many workers will not be able to realize their full potential. So there is complete threat to jobs. But I think what is so remarkable and encouraging is that the ILO also has international labor standards, some framework for us to respond to this crisis. And I think the first thing is the health challenges, you know, which is extremely important, is about life and death. And I think first, the health protection measure must be in place in the world of work. Workers have to be well protected. There should be personal hygiene. There should be industrial hygiene. I mean, Timothy, I commend you. You're at work now, you know, so we have to use our sanitizer. We have to wash our hands. We need to use our nose masks if we are going out. It's extremely important. But the second important thing is the economic response. I mean, it's true that more jobs will be lost. Many factories will close down. I'm also, you know, I used to be in the textile and garment sector. And the pictures coming out of many countries of the world, very, 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 very scary. You know, more factories are closing down because of the supply chains, you know, from China. And supplier, Thailand, Bangladesh, it's been a mess. Of course, Nigeria is just about to recover. So we are building industrial revival, and this has put a hold on it. So there will be job losses to that. But we can also turn this to opportunities, you know. And I think maybe this is where the discussion should be. I'm quite excited about the fiscal stimulus that our government has put in place or has announced, even though with all the efforts so far, the entire fiscal stimulus we have is still small compared to our GDP capacity. I think we need to spend more. And I think the quick one I would like to suggest is first, at the level of economic intervention, you need to pay the workers their salary very well to survive this lockdown. Any delay in salary is like you are delaying, you are really, you know, fast-forwarding the terrible impact of survival on the part of the workers. Not only that, there is direct social transfer, you know, the so-called conditional transfer, and I think it should be unconditional because all Nigerians deserve some support. And this is where I want to say to you is that the controversy over the social investment program and the Ministry of Humanitarian Affairs, I think is completely unhelpful. I think we should put an end to that controversy. Now we should face squarely the impact of coronavirus. and all the beneficiaries under the M-Power should be paid, just like you are paying the new vulnerable groups, the so-called poorest of the poor. I think this, all of us today, we are vulnerable in the country. So I think that the controversy should stop over the conditional social transfer. What we want to hear is that those who are in the old scheme, M-Power should be well paid. Those who are vulnerable groups, you know them, the youth, the women, the informal sectors, they should be well paid properly, as I went through. And that's the way they will survive. But as I said, this could also be an opportunity, you know. And I want to say that things like nose masks have to be produced locally. You know, I want to commend Governor Ayade of Cross River State, who has already set up a garment factory and is leveraging on this to get many workers employed. So even as well, there's a threat to jobs, we can create more jobs, you know, especially in the value chain of textile garment sector. Then the production of sanitizer should be done locally too. That could be an opportunity. And there should be arrangement for those who are working at a flexible time, you know, for them. You should also pay them very well so that they can be well motivated. So I want to say in summary that this could be an opportunity for us to also, as we are lamenting possible job losses, and there will be, we are lamenting the threat to lives. All we need to do is to respond. The best response is not to agonize, but to organize ourselves to confront the air challenge, you know, make sure that we keep to the instruction of the public health authorities, stay at home where we are directed, ensure social distancing, physical distancing. Of course, wash your hands and use your sanitizers. But the second level is also to address the economic challenges arising from that. People at home must eat, they must be protected, they must be paid very well. Pensioners have to be paid, you know, they're even more vulnerable. Don't forget the old people have underlying disease, they are more virtually vulnerable. So this is the time to pay pensioners as I went due, and even pay them beyond the minimum wage, you know, they shouldn't hand less, because this is not the time for survival. Now, Mr. Remu,
please may I come in here. Now, for a country such as Nigeria, that unemployment rate is as high as 23%, that is as at 2018, you know, what is Labour recommendation on how to stimulate the economy and protect jobs?
I think the first thing is that I mean, I agree with you that official figure is about 24%, but I've also told you that the unofficial figure is more than that. In fact, the open unemployment in this country, if you had underemployment, I mean, people pretend to be working when actually they are not having satisfaction, they are not well paid, they are also not well motivated. You find that open unemployment is close to almost about 50% in Nigeria. Now, what should be the way out? I think the way out is exactly what we're doing. We have to produce what we consume. We need to import substitutes. And this is where I want to commend the monetary authorities, you know, ably led by Governor of the CBN, that's Emefiele, you know, very proactive. He has reduced the interest rate, you know, from 9% to 5% for CBN-backed loans. This will boost the real economy, as the case may be. There are also moratorium on debt, you know, for some of the enterprises. So this one way to go. And then there should need for public works. I was happy when the Minister of Finance also announced the new initiative under the 500 billion support scheme. And the whole idea there would be public jobs to be created in 74 local government in the country. This is the way to go. You have to keep people possibly busy. And of course, we must now, in fact, I'm so happy that everybody is now brought to the need for us to build self-reliance. We must diversify the economy. We must add value to our raw materials instead of exporting goods. You know, we must beneficiate. I listened to the NNPC new decision on petroleum pricing, you know, even though that's quite controversial. But I think the energy of the NNPC should be out there, the refineries work. You know, there are many derivatives. You know, we can create a lot of jobs, you know, through petrochemicals, through the refineries, and that should be the way to go. So this should be a turning point for us to get good. But in all this, we need social dialogue, we need inclusion, and this thing, organized labor must sit up, you know, what the labor sectors have to engage with the employers, first to mitigate the impact of this crisis. They must use the existing collective bargaining agreement to find out that when workers are
paid, right,
they must be paid because it's not their fault. You know, then secondly, many unions also have resources. They must also transfer resources to their members. Now,
This is what workers pay union dues for. So if a worker could have 500 naira, 1,000 from their unions in this condition, that would go a long way to help them. Then they must also negotiate with all the state governments so that all the relief materials are channeled toward the workers who are at home, especially those who are also in the formal sector who have no voice. And I think with this, once the coronavirus is over, we must get going to make sure that we import substitutes, produce what we consume, consume what we produce, which is what President Buhari is already doing. And I think we need to consolidate on that more. But this is the way to go. The world just, we have to put ourselves.
All right. Thank you very much for your time, Issa Aremu, President, Industrial Global Union.